My aunt has a summer cottage up on the crossroads at East Vassalboro, Maine. One day last summer, I was out on the porch, rocking and reading the newspaper, when I heard a foreign sports car come up the road towards me and go right on through the west intersection. He jammed his brakes on down at the Barrens, turned around and come right on up again. He turned around way down at the blueberry factory and came straight on up. This time he stopped right out front.
Which way to East Vassalboro?
Don't you move a goddamn inch.
Hello. If you are channel surfing in Gatsis land, welcome to Ward 13. Don't you move a goddamn inch. John, are you going to leave me out here to hang? Why don't we just start the whole thing again? Start the right one. Hi, welcome to Gatsis land.
Wow.
We're having some technical difficulties. Two missing guests. I think that Gatsis is cracking down.
Yes, well.
My guest today is Matt Connarton.
Hello.
You were going to be my co-host.
Yeah, I guess now I'm the guest. Well.
Hopefully we will get through to Washington, D.C.
Yes.
And we'll be talking about environmental law and whistleblowing and a new initiative. But we're having a little trouble getting that to Washington. Now, when is that storm supposed to reach Washington? Not till Friday, right?
I think so.
Geez, maybe Donald Trump's been... Has Donald Trump gotten a hold of a nuclear device?
I certainly hope not. Well, you know, he... what did he say when asked about... Did you see the debate where he was asked about the nuclear triad and what his priority would be? And he had no idea. He just rambled for 60 seconds. He had no idea.
The only debate I ever saw was when I was in person.
Yeah.
And... Geez, I haven't even covered much this year.
Yeah.
Hey, do you know who Bert and I are?
Bert and I?
You're a New Hampshireite, right?
Yes.
I guess you have to be of a certain age. We started out. I think one of them was a guy from Harvard, and they did Down East humor.
Okay.
Down East humor. We started out with it, but everything started to go awry right from the beginning. John, show us East Millinocket. The video, East Millinocket. This is Bert and I. They're very popular in the late 60s.
I was standing outside Sutherland's IGA store one morning when I heard a flivver approaching down the street toward me.
Which way to Millinocket?
Well, you can go west at the next intersection. Get on to the turnpike. Go north through the toll gate at Augusta. Did you come to that intersection? Well, no. You could keep right on this tar road. It changes to dirt now and again. Just keep the river on your left. You'll come to crossroads and let me see. Then again, you can take that scenic coastal route that the tourists use. And after you get to Bucksport, well, let me see now. Millinocket. Come to think of it, you can't get there from here.
My aunt has a summer cottage up on the crossroads at East Vassalboro, Maine. One day last summer, I was out on the porch, rocking and reading the newspaper, when I heard a foreign sports car come up the road towards me and go right on through the west intersection. He jammed his brakes on down at the Barrens, turned around and come right on up again. He turned around, way down at the blueberry factory, and came straight on up. This time he stopped right out front.
Which way to East Vassalboro?
Don't you move a goddamn inch.
Well, that's some Don East humor. It failed to turn my guest Matt Connarton on, though. I say,
yeah.
I guess when we grew up, my uncle, who was married to my Aunt Kay by marriage, was Uncle Hickey.
Okay.
He's from Bedford. His name is Richard. It was probably Ricky, and then it became Hickey. So, you know, Hick humor used to be big in New Hampshire.
Sure.
Particularly when we could put it off on Maine.
Yeah.
Jesus, I'm getting old. I not only need a haircut, but I need the youth.
Right.
The fountain of youth. Now, well, I'm going to try to make another call.
Okay.
And, hey, you can show us what we have to do. John, show the technical side of our studio, our high-tech studio. We're trying to call on Skype. Oh, Christ, look at my hair in the back.
I dig that Word 13 graphic.
How come Amsterdam can get, you know, people to come on and give haircuts? And,
oh, the phone.
Geez.
it's your phone.
Oh, Paul, what's going on? Yep. I'm going to give you a call right now. Paul, we're actually on live TV. Thank God you can edit this stuff. Look how bald I am. It says Paul Lyons, Manchester TV.
The person whom you're trying to reach is currently unavailable. Please leave a message after the beep.
Well, I guess we don't have any message. You want me to call you on the why don't I give you the telephone number and you can call in? I don't know what's happening with Skype. Is there a problem on your end? Yeah, and give me a call, and then we'll Skype. All right? Give us we'll give you 15 minutes, okay? How long do you think you need? Okay, we'll contact you in 15 minutes. I'm sure we have enough to BS about. We're up here in New Hampshire. No. Live TV.
Yeah,
but we're calling you and nothing's happening. We're calling you and nothing's happening. Yeah. Okay, well, I'll Skype you in 5 minutes, okay? Okay, bye. Well, it looks like for our online audience, we're going to have like a 45-minute show. Kind of like Rich Gerard's show when people start calling in and mentioning a certain woman, but I'm not supposed to be.
Oh, yes.
She was in a hula hoop recently. Did you see that?
Yes.
I was going to cut it to the leader because in the 62 movie, Stanley Kubrick, of the novel The Leader,
yeah.
When James Mason as Humbert comes in and sees his nymphet, she's in a hula hoop.
Yeah.
And Jesus, you know, we live in a city beyond satire.
Yeah.
Matt, what's been going on?
Well, you know, I wasn't here last week, but in the interim, of course, the political...
Matt's over there.
The political world keeps on going. What do you think, you know, New Hampshire primary's not far. And
Bernie's going... 538, which is like the premier site for predicting... has, by polls only, they have 73, Bernie has a 73% chance of winning New Hampshire.
Yeah.
But Hillary's got an 80% chance of winning the Iowa caucuses.
Okay.
And you know the Iowa caucuses impact the New Hampshire primary.
Sure.
But I still think he's the favorite.
Yeah. Well, I think really what it hinges on is what happens when we get to South Carolina.
Oh, you mean afterwards?
Yeah.
Well, you know, there's this debate going on, of course, people, you know, social, what is it called? Democratic socialism means socialism.
Yeah.
It means anti-capitalist, you own the means of production. Although it got modified to, you know, we'll accept market mechanisms, like the Social Democratic Party in Germany or the Socialist Party in France.
Yeah.
But that's what, in 1972, the Socialist Party split up into three groups. Michael Harrington became the, you had one party became, I think it was the Democratic Socialist Party. Then there was Socialist Party USA, which Bernie Sanders was affiliated with. I don't know if he is now.
Yeah.
Through the Liberty Union, which is in Vermont. And then Michael Harrington had the Democratic Socialists.
Yeah.
But I know people from way back. You know, I studied this back at Boston University, plus the Soviet Union and everything. So democratic socialism means socialism that's not controlled out of Moscow.
Okay.
But it's funny how things are going to... you watch things being rewritten right now.
Yeah.
And a social democrat, the Social Democratic Party in Germany in the 30s was a socialist party. And under Willy Brandt, when I was in Germany... In the 80s, it's considered the Socialist Party. Mitterrand's party was considered the Socialist Party. Suddenly, you're going to they're social democrat. They're social democrat parties.
Yeah.
It's very strange what's going on. But after he wins the New Hampshire primary, if he does, or comes in close,
mm-hmm.
the press is going to discover, you know, all you have to do is go onto Wikipedia and look up democratic socialism.
Right.
And there's Bernie's name down there.
Sure.
But people are playing all these semantic games. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Bernie's being portrayed as a Lyndon Johnson type of Cracker Barrel, pork barrel Democrat.
Right,
and,
right.
And we'll see. That's not going to go over well. In South Carolina, though, they got caucuses and a primary.
Do they?
Yeah, it's a weird state.
Okay.
So...
Matt,
this is the weirdest election I've ever seen.
Yeah,
look at the Republicans.
Yeah.
Who's number two? Ben Carson? Or is it?
No, not anymore.
Cruz is coming up.
Cruz, right? Cruz, I think has a shot at winning Iowa.
Somebody like him always does.
Yeah.
Santorum won, remember?
I remember it was weird because he had won, but then I think they said at first he had won by 8 votes. And then it changed, remember. And they said, well, actually, maybe he didn't win. And at one point, I think it was discussed that Ron Paul might have actually won.
Right,
It kept changing.
And that helped Ron Paul, who came in second. And him coming in second knocked John Huntsman right out of the race.
Yeah, which was the one I liked out of the Republican field last time.
Yeah.
John Huntsman was the one I found the least terrifying.
Yeah, he looked like he could be a real president or prime minister.
Yeah.
But the Republican Party... There's no Mitt Romney and there's no John Huntsman.
Right, right.
I mean, I don't know Marco Rubio. I see him bloviating on the tube.
Yeah. I think the closest one to John Huntsman in the current field is John Kasich, who I actually kind of liked until he started talking about, I think it's time we punch the Russians in the mouth and this and that. He actually said that. And then I said, well, no, I'd rather not get into thermonuclear Armageddon.
World War III.
Yeah, I'd prefer to avoid that. So... But the Republicans, there's a lot of people who are really clinging to this idea that an establishment Republican is going to emerge and save them from Trump. And I don't think it's going to happen.
That can't happen in our system.
Yeah.
It's not like the old days.
Yeah.
And a lot of people were hoping Joe Biden would come and save people from Hillary.
Yeah, yeah.
And he couldn't get the money because she'd already sewn it up. It's cost so much money to run.
Mm-hmm.
I think the way it is that Hillary, you know, she's going to have her little troubles and stuff. But if you're going to run against a Ted Cruz, another Clinton in the White House.
Right, right.
But I've never seen a Republican field like this.
Yeah.
It's all – because the people that should be, like Kasich, a strong one, or even Walker, who's controversial, out of Wisconsin.
Yeah.
He just sank like a stone.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, he dropped out early. Yeah.
This is a freak show, man.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't want to cover it. I've had 2 tickets to go see Donald Trump.
Yeah.
I am going to go. Ted Cruz is going to be at Theo's, Joe Kelly Lavas's restaurant, Thursday.
Yeah.
Around noontime. I've got to go to that.
Yeah.
He's in California. And I had to go to the bathroom, and rather than go to a service station, I was going from Los Angeles up to Pebble Beach.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, right there was the Reagan Library. So I went to the bathroom there and got a cup of coffee, and I bought Joe Lavasser a Ronald Reagan Library cup.
Oh, yeah?
I don't have to give it to him.
Yeah.
I'll give it to him while Ted Cruz is around. But the problem I have with Ted Cruz is he looks – did you ever read the Archie comics?
Yeah.
If you put that little hat on him, wouldn't he look like Jughead?
Yes, you're right. You're right.
Which was created by Bob Montana of Manchester, New Hampshire.
I just still find it stunning that he and Marco Rubio are the same age.
How old are they?
They're both 44. And it's just
Marco Rubio's 44. He looks like he's 35.
I know. Yeah, he looks young. And Cruz just seems like this stodgy old conservative. He seems much older than 44. So,
what did Rubio ever do?
Nothing. I mean,
what did Cruz ever do before they got in the Senate?
Well, they're both.
Was Rubio ever a congressman or a governor?
No, they're both very young in their political careers in the grand scheme of things, which is another dynamic that's interesting. It's like we keep electing people with no experience.
Then you have Carson. Then you have Trump, who's, you know, his whole political platform is Donald Trump.
Yeah. Yeah.
You ever see the old videos of Donald Trump being like liberal?
Yeah, there's plenty of them.
Pro-choice.
Yeah, oh yeah.
But, because Obama only had how many years as a senator?
He was in his first term.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he'd been a state senator for only like one term.
Yeah.
But he was backed by Warren Buffett and the Union Bank of Switzerland, plus others.
Yeah.
Well, we can keep talking. Well, I'm going to try to make a call again.
Okay. So we're trying to get Paul.
Here we go.
Paul, is it Lyon or Lyons?
Paul Lyons.
Paul Lyons.
Jeez, I gained 11 pounds over the holiday.
Oh, have we got him?
Paul?
There
you are.
Success.
We've gotcha. We have been... Paul, we have been filling the time with... Down East humor. Where are you from, by the way, Paul?
I'm from upstate New York, around Albany.
No kidding.
Yeah.
I remember Albany well in the 70s. You know the government center that Rockefeller built? They used to call it Rocky's Folly. My father was in the wall trade. Actually, he was like, he was a different kind of Donald Trump. He used to go around selling aluminum siding and stuff and home improvements. And if you ever see the movie, Woody Allen's last great movie, what was it called? Deconstructing Harry, which everybody hated. When they really hate your movie, you know it's good. And he meets a man. He's in the ninth ring of hell in a suit. And he says, why are you here? He says, I invented aluminum siding. Now, that's a joke from the 50s, 60s, and 70s because people used to peddle it. Yeah. And somebody who knew who my father was, a politician, said he'd come back from a thing. He says, geez, we were talking about Donald Trump. He's got the soul of a siding salesman. He said, oh, I'm sorry about your father. He says, no, I agree totally.
Yeah.
So, in Albany, every four trucks that went into there, three of them just turned around. That's where I learned about municipal politics. Where do you live? You probably don't want to tell. Well, why not? Where did you come from around Albany?
It was actually Schenectady, which is a little bit north of there, and it was a suburb of that. But
how can you deny Schenectady? Isn't that General Electric?
Yeah, it's General Electric.
And you got the university there.
Hmm.
Okay, we're going to start a serious show now.
Okay.
We can always cut these. Paul, okay, we're going to start. We're going to have a countdown now.
All right, this is the real show here.
Okay.
All right, here we go.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. It's that type of day. 4, 3, 2, 1. Our guest today is Paul Lyons of the National Whistleblower Center. Paul, you've been our guest before. Matt Connarton is here, my co-host, and I understand, is it the National Whistleblower Center has launching a program to educate the public about, what would you call it, environmental whistleblowing?
Right. First of all, thank you so much for having me on again. And it's a real pleasure to be talking to you guys. Okay, so let's get into it. So there's a whole series of laws that come out of wildlife protection efforts. And these are all in response to what is really a growing massive crisis. There was a report issued recently where they projected that half of the entire world's wildlife had been driven to extinction, killed off in the last 40 years, right? That gives you an idea of the kind of scale that we're looking at.
So you're talking we're talking about the Endangered Species Act, which I'm sure everyone's heard about. Mm-hmm. And what is the Lacey Act?
Okay, so the Lacey Act was actually passed a long time before the Endangered Species Act, and so people who work in wildlife protection and environmental in general, they tend to be very familiar with the Lacey Act. But it's not an issue that most people are not aware of what the Lacey Act is or what it does. But it's the most comprehensive wildlife protection law. Second to that really is the Endangered Species Act, and you know, obviously that puts in place protections for all of the endangered species, not only on our list, but it also reads us into a series of conventions which honors also the endangered species lists of countries around the world.
Paul, how widespread is the trafficking in not only endangered animals, but isn't there, I read an article about this by Stephen Cohn, who is the president of National Whistleblower Center. It's not only trafficking in animals and fish, but it's also trafficking in stuff like hardwoods and that. How extensive is, this is corruption, obviously, and this is contraband. How extensive is the trade?
Okay, well, so to sort of touch on the issue of scope, so when you say wildlife in a general sense, most people think animals, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it also includes, but in a legal sense, wildlife means just anything that's alive and in the wild. And so you've got that covers how you run fisheries. It covers how you do agriculture, particularly with imports and exports. And it covers, yes, wildlife, yes, endangered species, also lumber and logging, which is a massive industry. There's a lot of money in that. So if we're going to talk dollar amounts total, the estimates range, but the current estimate from a joint report issued by UN and Interpol, they estimated it to be up to $143 billion a year.
$143 billion a year, and we're always hearing about the financing of terrorism and bloodletters and bad men by drugs. How much of, you know, that seems like a considerable amount of money. A lot of this is done in third world countries, right? Developing countries.
Well, so the origin points for most of wildlife trafficking, when you're talking especially about, you know, wildlife as in animals trafficking, that's almost all coming out of Africa. And then going to places like the U.S. and China tend to be big destination points. Just like any kind of smuggling or major criminal enterprise within developing nations that have terrorist or problems with violent militants in the area, the criminal enterprises are absolutely continuous with the terrorist enterprises. So you have smugglers, you have traffickers. The money is going to be going that way, at least in portion.
What about enforcement? I've got something here. I guess there were no awards granted under the Lacey Act in the past couple of years as far as whistleblowing.
Why is there? Matt has a chart here comparing financial whistleblowing awards, which we know. I think you were on before. What, you collected $50 billion or much more because of the whistleblowing laws. They've given out a tremendous amount of money. What are they giving out, Matt?
Yeah, it looks like under the over the last decade up until 2014, they were giving out, you know, one year they gave under the Lacey Act, one year they gave out $27,500, another year almost $69,000, and then you get to 2014 and 2015 and it's zero.
And how much were they giving out for financial whistleblowing on the other chart? Hundreds of millions?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Those numbers are huge. Yeah.
Why is there this discrepancy? You have $143 billion a year criminal enterprise.
Right.
You know, and I guess financial crime, maybe it's 10, at least a factor of 10. Why are there no awards being met?
Well, no, I mean, I think that's a factor. I mean, I think those are pretty consistently about 1,000 times larger.
Jeez.
You know, if you're jumping up from maybe like a couple hundred thousand a year to several hundred million, you know, and that's like in the smaller range of the difference, you know. So it is absolutely an order of magnitude. And the...
Can I interrupt you? In 2015, the government, under the False Claim, just the False Claims Act, remember the Lincoln Law of 1863 that got reauthorized in 1986 to fight Pentagon corruption, $600 million were paid out. In 2015, zero.
Yeah.
And under the Endangered Species Act, too.
Yeah,
zero.
Yeah.
Why?
Right, exactly. And as you said, $143 billion industry a year, a legal enterprise, I should say. So it's not as though there aren't malefactors to go after here and people to bust and, you know, fines to be collected and distributed to whistleblowers as awards. And that's all there. The question is, are you going to organize for it? And are you going to actually work on getting whistleblowers out of the woodwork? Because that's with the FCA, with other whistleblower laws, like the stuff that covers securities fraud in the stock market or commodities fraud or tax fraud. All of these things have associated offices They have professional practices, and they have ways of organizing the information and professional rights for people who want to work with whistleblowers professionally. And there's absolutely all these laws that authorize for whistleblowers to receive awards for reporting violations of wildlife protection laws. There's more than enough authority for establishing such an office and organizing the practice within the government. But the government has not acted at all. There's been 30 years of total inaction. I mean, you see some awards, but there's no office. Hmm. There are no regulations passed within these agencies. And there's no effort whatsoever to advertise the ability for whistleblowers to come in and report this information. And if you don't advertise, if you don't do any kind of outreach, you never get any whistleblowers.
Right.
Of course you don't.
So this is analogous in a way to financial whistleblowing. Now, Charles Grassley revived the False Claims Act in 1986 to go after the Pentagon. And later that was used to go after financial corruption like tax evasion.
Right.
The that's one of the first things. And they found, there were hearings back in 2006. They found billions and billions of dollars. Hmm. So this is analogous to that situation, like, let's say, 10 years ago, where maybe the law was there, but people weren't, the government wasn't bothering to enforce it, was it?
Well, you mean before they had a tax whistleblower provision incorporated into the tax code, or before anybody really used it?
Before anybody really used it. Because right. I'm reading here from Steve Cohn's article. They passed the Lacey Act 35 years ago. It actually had payments, you know, for whistleblowers. And the thing about whistleblowers, we've had this before on the show. We've had Dave Colapinto on the show, too, from the National Whistleblower Center. Eric Holder, the Attorney General, says that incentives for whistleblowers are the most powerful tool to combat fraud. He's whistleblower reward laws. Because you have to incentivize coming forward, because
right.
a whistleblower will have their career destroyed. And I can imagine when you're dealing with environmental whistleblowing, you could have your life endangered.
Get your well poisoned.
Exactly.
That's the case whenever we're dealing with any kind of foreign corruption. So we've done a lot of work with the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which prohibits bribery and brings in foreign whistleblowers. In that case, protecting the identity is absolutely paramount. So you need to protect their confidentiality, and you need to do a lot to incentivize the people to come forward, because they take enormous risks. And yeah, there's no guarantee that they have the protection of law, or even physical protection wherever they're at.
I would think in this area, we're not dealing with, besides like James Bond type of stuff, I think that inside the, and there have been some monkey business in the financial industry. I was in London in 1982 when they hired, what was his name, Mario Sidoni or whatever, the guy involved with the Vatican Bank, Blackfriars Bridge. I mean, usually England was a lot more staid then.
Okay, yeah.
Things like that happening. So that does happen, but I'm thinking in this world, there must be a lot of potential for retaliation against whistleblowers.
I would say so, yeah.
Here's an interesting thing Steve Cohn brings up in his article. In the Act to Prevent Pollution from Ships, I never thought there was an Act to Prevent Pollution of Ships.
Yeah.
Because we just don't think about that.
Right.
Almost all actions that were taken against ships that polluted came from whistleblowers who were rewarded, that were incentivized. And another thing he pointed out was that the vast majority of whistleblowers, even in a situation where there are rewards, don't come forward.
Yeah.
So, and the other thing, we have the Endangered Species Act. 35 years ago, the Lacey Act passed rewards. and they never made any implementing regulations. Because you can have a law, right, Paul? Right. But if you don't have the regulations, it doesn't get the, it doesn't work.
It's put it in a similar way, like if you can have a law, but if you don't enforce it, it's not a real law. You know, if you don't put it into action, and this is a part of a law that promises to be a really powerful tool. As you said, the Attorney General calls it the most powerful tool that they have at their disposal to fight fraud and corruption. Mary Jo White, the woman who runs the Securities Exchange Commission, calls it a tremendously effective force multiplier. It says it lays out entire blueprints of criminal enterprises. And we have all sorts of quotes to that effect, which show that whistleblowers have proven to be absolutely revolutionary whenever they're applied effectively to combating any kind of corruption. And as you see in the Department of Justice, 80% of their fraud cases, their fraud prosecutions, they come from whistleblowers because they've learned that that is just how you tackle fraud.
Seems to me like if there's not adequate enforcement of these things, then in a lot of cases it's somebody, whoever is doing the, whoever is violating the law, whoever is engaging in the corruption is really just kind of conducting a, from their perspective, and it's probably how they rationalize it, a cost-benefit analysis. It's like, okay, if I know I'm probably going to get away with this because there's no enforcement, I might as well do it and take the risk that no one's going to come forward.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure.
That was discussed in a quote from that report that I mentioned earlier, the UN and Interpol report, where they attributed the rise, particularly in illegal logging and transport, to the fact that these people, they just have no chance of being caught. You know,
I just pointed out to Matt, read the part I just pointed out to you from Steve Cohn's article.
Yeah, he writes here, one of the main reasons for the escalation in illegal wildlife trafficking is simple. It is a highly profitable business with a low risk of capture.
Right.
So, like I said, it comes down to a cost-benefit analysis. If the risk is low and the reward is high, people are going to do it.
Whistleblowers, knowing that anybody who's on your ship's crew could potentially report you and receive a reward, knowing that there might be people at the port who become aware of it, mm-hmm. or people who are working as guides who are aware of poachers acting in that area. There's so many people, very poor people often, who aren't interested in the overall goals of the criminal enterprise,
right.
Who are involved in the process. And once people know that they can report and receive awards for reporting and legal protection, then they're going to start doing that. And then the companies that are complicit in this and the criminal actors that are executing the whole thing, those people will start looking at their risks very, very differently.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what's going to drive down this wildlife trafficking enterprise, and it's going to make a serious impact on the wildlife crisis in general.
Mm. Geez, over as much as one-third of the wild caught seafood imported to the United States is illegal.
No kidding.
And 15,000 elephants were illegally killed in 2012 alone from 42 monitored sites. That means more than 15,000 elephants. And lions, I guess, I didn't know lions are basically being wiped out in parts of Africa.
Wow.
I didn't know lions were used. I know elephants they use. There's all sorts
the tusks.
There are projections out there right now that say, you know, lions, tigers, and rhinos, and elephants are all going to be extinct, particularly from Africa, just wiped out, the African lion and so forth. They're wiped out, in all of them, before 2040.
Wow, that's stunning. I had no idea.
25% of all declared wildlife shipments. The United States only inspects 25% of declared wildlife shipments. Jeez. Right.
So this
and
goes
none
to
of the undeclared shipments.
You basically have two options. Well, I suppose you have three options. Option one, ignore it. Let all these animals die. We lose a massive amount of our planet's natural wealth and resources. And there are huge biodiversity consequences to that. You see food chains falling apart. Just massive problems involved with that. Two, you increase, probably by several factors, the resources that are available to port inspectors and the Fish and Wildlife Service and so on, so that people, they can start inspecting everything that comes into ports. Because right now, they're looking at 25% of just things that are declared, you know? And if I was transporting ivory illegally, you know, I probably would not declare it, you know?
I guess.
So I think that, you know, the situation you're looking at over there is that there just are not nearly enough resources available to these people to ever catch up to what's going on here. And that leads to low risk of capture. Your third option, and this is what I think we really actually have to do, is you work with whistleblowers. You create an office, you bring whistleblowers forward, you start giving out awards, you get the word out there, and you let the people who are out in the field, you know, who know of this information personally, that work for you. I mean, that's the brilliant part of whistleblower programs in a law enforcement enterprise. Whistleblowers come forward and they do all the work for you. They lay out the whole blueprint. Then all of a sudden, you can just come crashing down on these traffickers or these tax fraudsters or whatever it is. They lay out the whole blueprint, and then law enforcement people, they can enforce the law, finally.
You know, Matt and Paul, until I read Steve Cohn's article, it's in the Environmental Law Reporter, January 2016, always thought that cracking down on illegal trafficking in animals like Africa, Asia, was done at the source.
Right.
I never thought about a way to stop the trafficking into the United States, because it seems like almost everything you see on TV or you can see stuff on the internet, always has to do with local efforts like in Africa or Asia to stop the trafficking.
Right.
I never thought about taking away the incentive at the, not at the source, but where, if you dry up the people that need, you know, or the demand.
Mm-hmm.
I never, until I read Steve's article. And is this then a matter of educating people? Because I've had a lot of environmentalists on the show, and
nobody knows about this.
Yeah.
No one knows. We
this
actually discovered this pretty much by accident. You know, we were talking to some people over at USAID, which is the agency out of the State Department, which helps with international development. And they, because they work on international development, they're very concerned about corruption. And there's some of them that work specifically on dealing with wildlife and environmental issues. So we were talking to them about how we could implement the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act in a way that would help them nail some of these traffickers. Because again, the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, that prohibits foreign bribery, and you can bring in whistleblowers under that. And a huge part of wildlife trafficking is bribery. You know, you just pay somebody off to look the other way while you smuggle your ivory in, or you bring in illegally fished seafood. And in that conversation, we were alerted to the importance of the Lacey Act, and they asked us to look into it. And when we did, we found we got this one little piece and then kept pulling and pulling until eventually we found that there were 44 different laws under which a whistleblower could come forward and receive an award for showing that there had been a violation of wildlife protections. So there's a whole comprehensive range here that shows a really clear intent on the part of Congress, actually, to deal with this issue and to deal with it through bringing whistleblowers forward, but it was completely forgotten about and never implemented by the agencies.
Well, you know, I'm reading the article, and here's then Congressman John Brough, who mm-hmm. was then a Democrat from Louisiana. When they were talking about the Lacey Act and a 1982 amendment to the Fish and Wildlife Improvement Act, explaining on the, I guess, on the floor of Congress, because you have to use undercover activities, you know.
Right.
You have to go undercover to actually break this trade, which whistleblowing. This is Steve Cohn. It's implicitly included in almost all whistleblower cases, you know, when you go undercover.
Yeah.
John Brough said it was difficult and dangerous, but highly successful, and said that the amendment to the Fish and Wildlife Improvement Act would help apprehend large-scale commercial violators of wildlife laws. Why this stuck out is John Brough hasn't been in the he became a senator and a Republican, and he hasn't been in the Senate for 9 years.
Yeah.
This is 33 years ago.
Wow.
It's just amazing. But, hey, the Lincoln Law was on the books from 1863 until 1986. When Charles Grassley revived it. And I'm going to tell you, Paul, they really did have like $600 toilet seats and wrenches. At my little tiny base, which I can't even really talk about,
yeah.
We had $100 pile of rags. I'll never forget that.
So that's not just an urban legend. That's really true. Wow. It's incredible.
They don't get it for you. It's the opposite of getting it for your holes.
Right, yeah, yeah. It's right. Quite the markup.
How we got the rags, I don't know. We used to get nothing. But,
well, and if you think about it, with government contracting, you have such a better chance of actually detecting that as a government agency. You get to do audits and stuff of that nature. But with wildlife trafficking, with the resources that are in existence at the moment and the way that it's distributed all around the world, there just is no chance. You have no opportunity. And so whistleblowers are even more needed over there. And it's a big industry. There's a ton of activity over there. There's a looming crisis with constant... I mean, I think a new species is going extinct every day.
Wow.
And the... So there's just a massive opportunity. There was clear will by our legislators back when they did these amendments, and it just hasn't been implemented. And so, you know, it's such a no-brainer, you know? So what we're doing right now is a combination of we're talking to the agencies about implementing this in an aggressive way. We're educating the public. And we're working on collaborating with NGOs who are working around the world, wildlife protection NGOs, so that they can reach out to people on the ground and let them know that they can become whistleblowers. And we think all of these three components together, they're going to be hugely impactful. And I think, you know, if you, like, $100 toilet seat is a pretty impressive thing.
$600.
$600 toilet seat.
And we're not talking Donald Trump's bathroom.
I do think you're going to see some pretty amazing stuff in the next couple of years. If we're successful with this, you're going to see some pretty amazing stuff coming out of combating the wildlife trafficking situation in a serious way.
We were talking earlier about, you know, potential whistleblowers not knowing about the incentives to come forward and whatnot. Is this from that same article, John?
Yes.
Steve Cohn's article. It says here, extensive review of the websites of the agencies responsible for paying whistleblower rewards failed to identify any information whatsoever about the reward laws on their website. NOAA's Office of Law Enforcement only has a toll-free number posted for reporting violations. It offers both a phone number and an email address. However, none of these websites mention anything about a whistleblower's right to obtain a reward. So they don't even tell you.
Right. Well, I'll do one better than that. And I believe this is also in the article. The Fish and Wildlife Service They do have some internal procedures about determining eligibility for an award, which is according, you know, and you can see in the charts that are included in that article as well, that's very sparely applied. But, you know, we go on looking around for information on this, and we hit a wall. You know, it said, okay, click through here to go and access this information about eligibility. And we clicked through it, and you know what it said?
What?
Confidential law enforcement privilege. You know, there's even, if you want to find out the information, you aggressively search for it, it is not available.
Wow.
We got the information eventually through doing a FOIA process. It's Freedom of Information Act.
Yeah. You had to do a Freedom of Information Act to find out about federal law and
exactly, and
programs?
You wonder why you're not getting whistleblowers. I mean, they can't figure out what your policies are.
How long did it take to get that through the FOIA?
Well, they were actually pretty cooperative.
That's
once
good.
We got them on the phone. So it only took a little while, a couple
That's
of
good.
Weeks.
Yeah.
We have to call Chuck Grassley and kick some butt. Just remember, whistleblowing is very bipartisan, isn't it, Paul?
Yeah, right. I mean, the Democrats, well, I think there's actually opposition on both sides, and there's support on both sides. So the term I use is transpartisan.
Oh, we were talking about broader issues. Yeah, I was at the Democratic debate and met Barney Frank, but I'll tell you that story offline. Yeah. He's here thumping the tub for Hillary Clinton, you know. But once again, Dodd-Frank, just like Sarbanes-Oxley, we're talking about, you know, financial laws.
Right. Some of these things
it's about
that
the
we're talking about
implementation
right
and regulation, isn't it? You can pass the law, but you've got to implement. It's the way it's implemented.
Right.
And you fight over those regulations, don't you?
Well, yeah, we do. We do. We're always, I mean, the devil is in the details, right?
Oh, yeah.
So you... a lot of the time, there are regulatory changes or regulations get changed, and we see a lot of danger in that for whistleblowers. We always go to fight in that situation, just generally speaking. But I agree with you, there's a lot of bipartisan support for whistleblowers. Is on the one hand, you see a lot of action on dealing with corporate accountability and corruption, in laws like Sarbanes-Oxley and the Dodd-Frank Act. So those tend to be very popular with Democrats, especially lately. But meanwhile, you also, all of these laws, every single one that has a whistleblower provision in it, Chuck Grassley's office was right on it, you know,
right.
Working out those whistleblower provisions every time, you know.
It was a Republican, that
right.
revived
well,
the false
he's
claim.
He's one of the most senior Republicans in the Senate.
Yes.
An absolute leader within the party. So it's just... both sides are working together, and there's a number of other Republicans. You know, I think it bears mentioning that the Senate Whistleblower Protection Caucus is 12 members.
Right.
Six are Republicans, six are Democrats.
Yeah. Well, they know how much money financial whistleblowing saves saves the United States. How much money? What is it? $50 billion it's put back in the treasury.
That sounds right. Yeah.
Which, but I find this amazing to find out that you have these laws and that they don't even enforce them. They didn't even bother to create the regulations.
Right.
They don't create on the sites to tell anybody. Now, in a whistleblower law, that has to be posted now, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, even the New Hampshire whistleblower
is to incentivize people to be whistleblowers. That's the point of having awards, right?
Right.
So if you don't communicate that to anybody, how are you going to incentivize them?
Right.
So when I'm down, like in Los Angeles or Boston at the port, and a lot of people don't understand, when you go to a port like L.A. or Boston, there are warehouses that when the stuff's in there, you're not in the United States.
Yeah.
Technically, you're not in the United States. What that's about,
that's
interesting. I was foolish and didn't go to law school. I was going to write the great American novel. You did right, so did Dave. But so in other words, the Lacey Act and this. That, when you're a customs official, that's not posted, is it?
No.
It helps you turn that blind eye.
Yeah, exactly.
Because, you know, trade. Trade
yeah, but
is
can you imagine if it was?
Yeah.
You know, because their bribes are not big enough to beat out the awards like that could be paid for reporting it.
Right.
You know?
That would be
all of a sudden the business becomes untenable. And it would have to shut down.
It yeah. would. That would do it in. And let's be frank, like it said in Steve's article more than once, most whistleblowers, even with incentives, don't come forward because you face retaliation.
Yeah.
And so
they do their own cost-benefit analysis, right, in a sense.
And people will criticize, you know, well, you're giving an incentive to a whistleblower. But the fact is, you show England, with its financial whistleblower laws, there is no financial incentive.
Right.
And there's probably a reason for that. They yeah. don't work, and yeah. they weren't meant to work. And here, it actually works.
Right.
And this goes back. It only does it 1863 with Abraham Lincoln cracking down at Civil War corruption. It goes back to like the 13th century in England. The English always would pay bounties for corrupt, you know, to bring somebody in for mm-hmm. corruption, because that's just the way people are.
Yeah.
You know, because you're taking such a risk.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
Well, we only have.
On the one hand, there's a simple calculation about, you know, what is the value of the thing that this person helps the government to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like billions and billions of dollars a year. I think some payment to the people who bring in that money is warranted. I mean, it's just an exchange for services and information. On the other hand, you know, you have to think about the risks that people take on.
Right.
You know,
right.
they lose yeah. their careers. They get harassed. You know, so a lot of times people walk away with very real cases of post-traumatic stress disorder.
Oh, yeah.
From being a whistleblower.
Paul, we only got about a minute, so I'm going to have to wrap up now. But we're going to have you back. You know,
it's absolutely worth it, is my takeaway. And you can find that article online on globalwhistleblowers.org.
Okay. We'll have you back. Matt and I want to talk to you about national security whistleblowing. When I was down there years ago, I typed up all the stuff from the conference. We have Edward Snowden is going to be Skyping to Manchester.
Yeah, Liberty Forum. Yeah, he's the
I'll talk to you
speaker.
About that later. But always good to see you. And
thank you, Paul.
Take care. And now I got to sign off to Manchester, New Hampshire is now known as Gatsisland, Paul, because of our mayor. It's just like Lionel Barrymore in the what is it? It's a Wonderful Life. Well, Jimmy Stewart didn't survive, so we live in Gatsisland.
That's right.
So to Gatsisland, we'll see you next week at Ward 13.